Look at the next verse in the longest sentence in the Bible. In whom we have redemption through his blood.
Had to take a little break there because of the static. But
now that's a word
we'll continue here
in church,
with David Jeremiah being accepted.
Distinguishing terms and talk about redemption. What is that? What does it mean to be redeemed? Well, in the Greek language, Paul used to write this letter, to redeem something meant to buy it back and cause it to be set free. We think of redemption primarily as a theological concept, but it carried more of a financial association in the ancient world. My wife, Don, and I have had the privilege of traveling around the country a lot. Some years back, we stopped in a southern city and stayed at a hotel. While we were checking in, the concierge said to us, be sure you go and see the marketplace. I said, why is that so important? I mean, after all, if you're married to my wife, you've been to a lot of marketplaces, right? I'll never forget his answer. He said, just about a block from this hotel is one of the old slave markets they used to use to sell and buy slaves. But they've turned it into a kind of flea market. And you ought to go down there and see it. Well, we went down, and I have to tell you, I had the eeriest feeling while we were there. I was walking through a place that represented one of the worst moments in the history of our nation. A period in which men and women created in the image of Almighty God were bought and sold like pieces of property. Just like the various goods being marketed and purchased at that flea market today. It's a terrible thought. Terrible image, but I want you to keep that image in mind as you read Romans 6, 17 and 18. But God be thanked that though you were slaves of sin, yet you obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine to which you were delivered, and having been set free from sin, you became slaves of righteousness. What a wonderful text that. The Bible says that you and I used to be slaves on the slave market of sin. What does that mean? Before you come to Christ, it's impossible for you not to sin. I mean, you still sin after you become a Christian, but it doesn't have to be that way. But before you have a power within you to help you not to do sinful things, you're a slave to it. You say, well, I'm a good person. But you know, the Bible doesn't look at it that way. The Bible looks at it not only by what you do, but the motives you have by doing it. What is your purpose? Before you become a Christian, you don't have the ability not to sin. So you become kind of like a slave. You're caught up in the slave market of sin. But one day Almighty God came down to buy us back. Did you know what he used for collateral? He used his own son, Jesus Christ, and his precious blood. He bought us by the precious blood of Christ off of the slave market of sin. And that blood was spilled on the altar of the cross, and he bought us back so that we could be free not to sin and free to do right. He redeemed us. We are chosen, we are adopted, we are accepted, we are redeemed. And then it says, we are enlightened, verses 8 and 9. This is kind of a wordy text, but we won't get too much into it. Let's read it. Which he made to abound toward us all in wisdom and prudence, having made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in himself. Now there's two phrases here that I want you to notice. First, God's riches and grace abound toward us in these ways, through wisdom and prudence. When we become Christians, God gives us a certain kind of wisdom and prudence. And then God makes known to us the mystery of his will. This goes back to the idea that before you become a Christian, you can't understand God. You can't understand godly things. You just wonder, what is that all about? What are those crazy people doing that think that? Well, let me give you a verse of scripture that explains it. 1 Corinthians 2:14 says, but the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him. He cannot know them because they are spiritually discerned. What Paul is saying is that before you become a Christian, you can't understand. I've had so many people that I've talked to over the years, telling them about my faith in Jesus Christ and leading them to a relationship with Christ. And they say something like this. One guy once told me, you know, I used to try to read that Bible you have, and it never made any sense. And he said, then I accepted Christ, and in the meantime, somebody rewrote the Bible. And what he meant was that now that he had the Holy Spirit in his heart, he began to understand the Bible. We can't understand spiritual things in the natural. We need the spiritual. And the Bible says that when you become a Christian, what happens is that you become capable of understanding the mysteries of God. There's a verse in John, basically it says this: if you want to know God's will as a Christian, you can know it, and that's a promise of God. The issue is sometimes we don't want to know it. We want to know it so we can measure it against our other options. You have to know the will of God so you will do it. You have to say, okay, Lord, tell me what to do, and I promise you when you tell me what to do, I'll do it. That's how you find the will of God. We are chosen and adopted and accepted and redeemed and enlightened. And then the Bible says we have an inheritance waiting for us. Ephesians 1, 11 and 12. In him also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, that we who first trusted in Christ should be to the praise of his glory. Now listen, if you're a follower of Christ, you have an inheritance that is reserved especially for you. Because you are mature sons and daughters in God's family, because you have been adopted into his family and you have been accepted by the Father, you have all the rights and privileges that come with that legal status. And one of those rights and privileges is an inheritance that is a special blessing each of us will receive one day. Let me give you a little thought. If you are putting all your resources in what you have here today, you are gradually moving away from your treasure. If you put your resources in the things of God, you are gradually moving toward your reward. You got to make a choice. What is that inheritance? What does he mean when he says we're going to get an inheritance? I don't really understand that completely, but the Apostle Peter offered us a little more in terms of a description. He said, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you." In other words, Peter says, you are a Christian and God has a special reward, a special inheritance for you in heaven. Notice how he describes it. It's incorruptible, it's undefiled, and it doesn't fade away. It isn't subject to inflation, praise the Lord. I read a sad story about a woman named Kathy from Astoria, Oregon, who passed away inside a homeless shelter. Much of Kathy's life was difficult, and she had addicted herself to drugs. She was suffering from mental health issues. She was alone and disconnected, spent years on the street with no safe place to call home. In other words, she needed a lot of help. But the saddest part of her story is this. Her mom had passed away some years before and left her daughter $884,000 deposited in a state bank. And people had tried to connect Kathy with the money she was owed. There were newspaper ads and even a private investigator hired to locate her. But unfortunately, Kathy was never found and the money remained unclaimed at the time of her death. I'm going to tell you that won't happen with your inheritance. God has promised to us it is incorruptible and it is reserved in heaven for you. Whatever the nature of that may be, it's more wonderful than anything you can imagine. It's more grand than anything you can possibly write down on a sheet of paper. We have an inheritance. And then number seven is we are sealed. In him you also trusted after you heard the word of truth, the gospel of salvation, in whom also, having believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. What does that mean, we were sealed? The Bible says this. When you become a Christian, a number of things happen at that moment. One of them is that the Holy Spirit comes to live within you, comes to live within your heart. Not your heart muscle, but the heart of who you are, the real you, your personality, your spirit, your soul. The Holy Spirit comes to indwell you. You say, well, I always thought that you had to do something after you got saved, and then you get to the Bible says you can't be a Christian without the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit comes to live within you. Most people live their whole lives and don't realize the tremendous resource they have living inside of them. The Holy Spirit enabling them to live their lives in a way they could never imagine. And when the Holy Spirit comes to live within you, that Holy Spirit serves as a seal that you are God's. He is the guarantee that tells you no matter what is happening in your life, things are going to be okay because God is with you. He's in you. And the best way I can explain that is what happens when you send a piece of registered mail. When you go to the post office and you fill out a form and give them the letter, and then they stamp a seal on that letter so that nobody can open it without the recipient knowing what happened. That seal provides a guarantee for the authenticity of the letter. The Bible says the Holy Spirit is the guarantee that what God promised from the past, he's going to fulfill in the future. How do I know I'm going to get what God has for me? The Bible says the Holy Spirit lives in my heart. How do I know the Holy Spirit lives in my heart? Because the Bible says he witnesses with my spirit that I am a child of God. And so the Bible tells us one of the blessings we get when we become a Christian is the guarantee that everything that God promised to us, he will fulfill. We are Christians. The Holy Spirit is the seal. Because we have the Holy Spirit, we know that one day everything he says is true is going to happen. As followers of Jesus, we are chosen, adopted, accepted, redeemed, enlightened, given an inheritance, sealed, and now finally, we are secure. Notice again verse 14, the guarantee of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession to the glory. Some older translations of Scripture replace the word guarantee with the word earnest. You ever hear of earnest money? Do you know what earnest money is? We don't use that term very often, but it's a real estate term. And when you go to buy a piece of real estate, you put down some earnest money so that you're not just messing with them and they're not wasting their time. Usually it's enough to be painful if you lose it. So earnest money is the idea that you're going to buy this house that you've seen. By making that payment, you are showing the seller that your offer is serious. You are putting your money where your mouth is. In a similar way, the Holy Spirit is the earnest money for our inheritance. He has provided part of our inheritance so that we can rest assured and rest secured in his promise that he is going to take us one day to be with the Father. To say all of that in another way, once we receive the blessing of the Holy Spirit in our lives, our salvation is secured. The Spirit is proof positive that you and I will be in heaven one day. Some of you might want to argue over the doctrine of eternal security. You go ahead and argue, but don't argue with me because I already made up my mind. I've read the Bible, and the Bible says when the Holy Spirit comes to live within you, God doesn't come and take him away. And as long as you have the Holy Spirit in your heart, you're on your way to heaven.
Praise the Lord.
How are we to say what we need to say to all these blessings? Ephesians 1, 3 and 14 says it this way. All praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms because we are united with Christ. He did this so we would praise and glorify him. It was a sad day in the Williams household when they learned their neighbor, Ken Watson, had passed away. Ken's death wasn't a surprise. He was 87. He suffered a lot of setbacks in his health. But Owen Williams and his wife knew that Ken's passing would be especially difficult for their young daughter, Katie. You see, Katie was only 2 years old at the time, and she had a special connection with Mr. Watson. In fact, he treated her more like a granddaughter than a neighbor. Made special effort to deliver Christmas presents every year, and his passing would leave a really empty place, not only within their neighborhood and street, but in little Katie's heart as well. Thankfully, that's not the end of the story. It turns out Ken Watson had one more trick up his sleeve before he died, or to say it more accurately, one more gift to give. Shortly after Ken's death, his daughter stopped by with William's home carrying a large bag. She said it was for Katie. Inside were 14 gifts Ken had purchased for his friend. 14 wrapped gifts to bless the young girl for the next 14 Christmases. He said, I kept reaching into the bag and pulling out another gift. Seemed like they would never end, 14 of them in that bag. The gifts that Ken Watson left Katie Williams were something special indeed. But the gifts God has showered on us are infinitely better. Upon his death, Mr. Watson delivered 14 gifts to last for 14 years. But God the Father has lavished us with every spiritual blessing that span the horizon of time from eternity past to the eternity of the future and right into our lives today. So we have been blessed even more than little Katie. We have been blessed with eternal blessings.
Amen.
Chronicled for us in this longest verse in the Bible. Amen. Well, it's
Amen.
Friday, and I hope you're ready for the weekend.
Amen. Thank you, David Jeremiah. And thank you, Gil and Jan Hammond. Most of all, thank you, Miss June Diamond Stevenson and my family. I want you all to know I love you very much as we celebrate our birthdays. August the 31st for Miss June, September the 4th for myself, being together. You are so beautiful to me. You are so beautiful to me. Can't you see? You're everything I hope for. You're everything I need. You are so beautiful to God. Are you ready? Are you ready? Jesus is knocking on your heart's door. Open your heart and invite him in. Like Miss June did many years ago. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Pass the ammunition of godly principles. Red, yellow, brown, black, and white were all precious in Jesus' sight. Find you a church to go to, as Billy Diamond would say. There's a chair waiting for you at any church. God bless you all. And God bless my wonderful wife, Miss June Diamond Stevenson, the love of my life. And my children, Guido Guy Stevenson, his wife Amy, and the grandkids and the kids, and Holly Smith Stevenson, bless her heart, Johnson. Bless her and Bill, Holly and Bill Johnson. Bless Pam. Pam and all the children. Cody and Ike, gone off to college. And of course that wonderful Beau Archer. What a wonderful man, a wonderful mother, and a wonderful father and family. And Pam's family. Don and Jim. And the Bentons. And the Stevens. How wonderful. And of course, little Colleen Michelle Garnett Stevenson Fox. Bless her little heart. Watch over her and protect her. Watch over Jeff. And give him wisdom. In Jesus' name we do ask it for all of them. But particularly tonight, for our birthdays, my wife, Miss June, and all of her family members that are sick and ill and fighting illnesses and bones broken and sickness. Watch over them. Give them strength. Lonnie and Sil in particular, Jim and Kathy, and Rose and Jim and Heidi and Dave and Keith and Kenny and Jenny and Amy and all their families. Watch over them. Miss June and Joe B and Donna. Bless their hearts, their family. And watch over me, Lord, and give me strength, energy, going into my 81st year. be with my friends, the Hammonds, in their mid-80s. Praise the Lord. And watch over our radio station, WIOK 107.5 FM on the radio dial. Post Office Box 50, Falmouth, Kentucky, 41040 zip code. If you got any questions, give me a call, 859-750-0000. Protect little Rachel driving in here from Arizona. Find her a place to live, a place where she can worship the Lord, play some music, and sing some music. In Jesus' name we do ask it. Amen. Watch over Mary Shulkers. Be with her. Darius has gone on to heaven. All of your other friends need prayers. Jim Noakes and Larry Hensley. Pray for him, Lord. Pray for him. And Stephen Brander. Pray for him. And Susan Brander. Pray for her. Lift their spirits up. Forgive them, Lord. For they know not what they do. In Jesus' name we ask it for all of them. Amen. Including our justice system, which needs to be lifted up and corrected and realize the injustice that they sometimes they do, knowingly and unknowingly. Thank you, Lord. Thank you very much. God bless you. Have a great day. 859-750-0000. Join us on YouTube and Facebook under Travels with Dr. John Stevenson. STEPHENSON.
Look at the next verse in the longest sentence in the Bible. In whom we have redemption through his blood.
I had to take a little break there because of the static. But
now that's a word
we'll continue here
church,
with David Jeremiah being accepted.
Distinguishing terms and talk about redemption. What is that? What does it mean to be redeemed? Well, in the Greek language, Paul used to write this letter, to redeem something meant to buy it back and cause it to be set free. We think of redemption primarily as a theological concept, but it carried more of a financial association in the ancient world. My wife, Don, and I have had the privilege of traveling around the country a lot. Some years back, we stopped in a southern city and stayed at a hotel. While we were checking in, the concierge said to us, be sure you go and see the marketplace. I said, why is that so important? I mean, after all, if you're married to my wife, you've been to a lot of marketplaces, right? I'll never forget his answer. He said, just about a block from this hotel is one of the old slave markets they used to use to sell and buy slaves. But they've turned it into a kind of flea market. And you ought to go down there and see it. Well, we went down, and I have to tell you, I had the eeriest feeling while we were there. I was walking through a place that represented one of the worst moments in the history of our nation. A period in which men and women created in the image of Almighty God were bought and sold like pieces of property. Just like the various goods being marketed and purchased at that flea market today. It's a terrible thought, terrible image. But I want you to keep that image in mind as you read Romans 6, 17 and 18. But God be thanked that though you were slaves of sin, yet you obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine to which you were delivered, and having been set free from sin, you became slaves of righteousness. What a wonderful text that is. The Bible says that you and I used to be slaves on the slave market of sin. What does that mean? Before you come to Christ, it's impossible for you not to sin. I mean, you still sin after you become a Christian, but it didn't have to be that way. But before you have a power within you to help you not to do sinful things, you're a slave to it. You say, well, I'm a good person. Yeah, but you know, the Bible doesn't look at it that way. The Bible looks at it not only by what you do, but the motives you have by doing it. What is your purpose? Before you become a Christian, you don't have the ability not to sin. So you become kind of like a slave. You're caught up in the slave market of sin. But one day Almighty God came down to buy us back. Did you know what he used for collateral? He used his own son, Jesus Christ, and his precious blood. He bought us by the precious blood of Christ off of the slave market of sin. And that blood was spilled on the altar of the cross. And he bought us back so that we could be free not to sin and free to do right. He redeemed us. We are chosen, we are adopted, we are accepted, we are redeemed. And then it says, we are enlightened, verses 8 and 9. This is kind of a wordy text, but we won't get too much into it. Let's read it. Which he made to abound toward us all in wisdom and prudence, having made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in himself. Now there's two phrases here that I want you to notice. First, God's riches and grace abound toward us in these ways, through wisdom and prudence. When we become Christians, God gives us a certain kind of wisdom and prudence. And then God makes known to us the mystery of his will. This goes back to the idea that before you become a Christian, you can't understand God. You can't understand godly things. You just wonder, what is that all about? What are those crazy people doing that think that? Well, let me give you a verse of scripture that explains it. 1 Corinthians 2:14 says, but the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him. He cannot know them because they are spiritually discerned. What Paul is saying is that before you become a Christian, you can't understand. I've had so many people that I've talked to over the years, telling them about my faith in Jesus Christ and leading them to a relationship with Christ. And they say something like this. One guy once told me, you know, I used to try to read that Bible you have, and it never made any sense. And he said, then I accepted Christ, and in the meantime, somebody rewrote the Bible. And what he meant was that now that he had the Holy Spirit in his heart, he began to understand the Bible. We can't understand spiritual things in the natural. We need the spiritual. And the Bible says that when you become a Christian, what happens is that you become capable of understanding the mysteries of God. There's a verse in John. Basically, it says this. If you want to know God's will as a Christian, you can know it, and that's a promise of God. The issue is sometimes we don't want to know it. We want to know it so we can measure it against our other options. You have to know the will of God so you will do it. You have to say, okay, Lord, tell me what to do, and I promise you when you tell me what to do, I'll do it. That's how you find the will of God. We are chosen and adopted and accepted and redeemed and enlightened. And then the Bible says we have an inheritance waiting for us. Ephesians 1, 11 and 12. In him also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, that we who first trusted in Christ should be to the praise of his glory. Now listen, if you're a follower of Christ, you have an inheritance that is reserved especially for you. Because you are mature sons and daughters in God's family, because you have been adopted into his family and you have been accepted by the Father, you have all the rights and privileges that come with that legal status. And one of those rights and privileges is an inheritance that is a special blessing each of us will receive one day. Let me give you a little thought. If you are putting all your resources in what you have here today, you are gradually moving away from your treasure. If you put your resources in the things of God, you're gradually moving toward your reward. You got to make a choice. What is that inheritance? What does he mean when he says we're going to get an inheritance? I don't really understand that completely, but the Apostle Peter offered us a little more in terms of a description. He said, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you. In other words, Peter says, you are a Christian and God has a special reward, a special inheritance for you in heaven. Notice how he describes it. It's incorruptible, it's undefiled, and it doesn't fade away. It isn't subject to inflation, praise the Lord. I read a sad story about a woman named Kathy from Astoria, Oregon, who passed away inside a homeless shelter. Much of Kathy's life was difficult, and she had addicted herself to drugs. She was suffering from mental health issues. She was alone and disconnected, spent years on the street with no safe place to call home. In other words, she needed a lot of help. But the saddest part of her story is this. Her mom had passed away some years before and left her daughter $884,000 deposited in a state bank. And people had tried to connect Kathy with the money she was owed. There were newspaper ads and even a private investigator hired to locate her. but unfortunately Kathy was never found and the money remained unclaimed at the time of her death. I'm going to tell you that won't happen with your inheritance. God has promised to us it is incorruptible and it is reserved in heaven for you. Whatever the nature of that may be, it's more wonderful than anything you can imagine. It's more grand than anything you can possibly write down on a sheet of paper. We have an inheritance. And then number seven is we are sealed. In him you also trusted after you heard the word of truth, the gospel of salvation, in whom also, having believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. What does that mean, we were sealed? The Bible says this. When you become a Christian, a number of things happen at that moment. One of them is that the Holy Spirit comes to live within you, comes to live within your heart, not your heart muscle, but the heart of who you are, the real you, your personality, your spirit, your soul. The Holy Spirit comes to indwell you. You say, well, I always thought that you had to do something after you got saved, and then you get to, the Bible says you can't be a Christian without the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit comes to live within you. Most people live their whole lives and don't realize the tremendous resource they have living inside of them. The Holy Spirit enabling them to live their lives in a way they could never imagine. And when the Holy Spirit comes to live within you, that Holy Spirit serves as a seal that you are God's. He is the guarantee that tells you no matter what is happening in your life, things are going to be okay because God is with you. He's in you. And the best way I can explain that is what happens when you send a piece of registered mail. When you go to the post office and you fill out a form and give them the letter, and then they stamp a seal on that letter so that nobody can open it without the recipient knowing what happened. That seal provides a guarantee for the authenticity of the letter. The Bible says the Holy Spirit is the guarantee that what God promised from the past, he's going to fulfill in the future. How do I know? I'm going to get what God has for me. The Bible says the Holy Spirit lives in my heart. How do I know the Holy Spirit lives in my heart? Because the Bible says he witnesses with my spirit that I am a child of God. And so the Bible tells us one of the blessings yet when we become a Christian is the guarantee that everything that God promised to us, he will fulfill. We are Christians. The Holy Spirit is the seal. Because we have the Holy Spirit, we know that one day everything he says is true is going to happen. As followers of Jesus, we are chosen, adopted, accepted, redeemed, enlightened, given an inheritance, sealed, and now finally, we are secure. Notice again verse 14, the guarantee of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession to the glory. Some older translations of Scripture replace the word guarantee with the word earnest. You ever hear of earnest money? Do you know what earnest money is? We don't use that term very often, but it's a real estate term. And when you go to buy a piece of real estate, you put down some earnest money so that you're not just messing with them and they're not wasting their time. Usually it's enough to be painful if you lose it. So earnest money is the idea that you're going to buy this house that you've seen. By making that payment, you are showing the seller that your offer is serious. You are putting your money where your mouth is. In a similar way, the Holy Spirit is the earnest money for our inheritance. He has provided part of our inheritance so that we can rest assured and rest secured in his promise that he is going to take us one day to be with the Father. To say all of that in another way, once we receive the blessing of the Holy Spirit in our lives, our salvation is secured. The Spirit is proof positive that you and I will be in heaven one day. Some of you might want to argue over the doctrine of eternal security. You go ahead and argue, but don't argue with me because I already made up my mind. I've read the Bible, and the Bible says when the Holy Spirit comes to live within you, God doesn't come and take him away. And as long as you have the Holy Spirit in your heart, you're on your way to heaven.
Praise the Lord.
How are we to say what we need to say to all these blessings? Ephesians 1, 3 and 14 says it this way. All praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms because we are united with Christ. He did this so we would praise and glorify him. It was a sad day in the Williams household when they learned their neighbor, Ken Watson, had passed away. Ken's death wasn't a surprise. He was 87. He suffered a lot of setbacks in his health. But Owen Williams and his wife knew that Ken's passing would be especially difficult for their young daughter, Katie. You see, Katie was only 2 years old at the time, And she had a special connection with Mr. Watson. In fact, he treated her more like a granddaughter than a neighbor, made special effort to deliver Christmas presents every year. And his passing would leave a really empty place, not only within their neighborhood and street, but in little Katie's heart as well. Thankfully, that's not the end of the story. It turns out Ken Watson had one more trick up his sleeve before he died, or to say it more accurately, one more gift to give. Shortly after Ken's death, his daughter stopped by with William's home carrying a large bag. She said it was for Katie. Inside were 14 gifts Ken had purchased for his friend. 14 wrapped gifts to bless the young girl for the next 14 Christmases. He said, I kept reaching into the bag and pulling out another gift. Seemed like they would never end, 14 of them in that bag. The gifts that Ken Watson left Katie Williams were something special indeed, but the gifts God has showered on us are infinitely better. Upon his death, Mr. Watson delivered 14 gifts to last for 14 years. But God the Father has lavished us with every spiritual blessing that span the horizon of time from eternity past to the eternity of the future and right into our lives today. So we have been blessed even more than little Katie. We have been blessed with eternal blessings.
Amen.
Chronicled for us in this longest verse in the Bible. Amen. Well, it's Amen. Friday, and I hope you're ready for the weekend.
Amen. Thank you, David Jeremiah. And thank you, Gil and Jan Hammond. Most of all, thank you, Miss June Diamond Stevenson and my family. I want you all to know I love you very much as we celebrate our birthdays. August the 31st for Miss June, September the 4th for myself. Being together. You are so beautiful to me. You are so beautiful to me. Can't you see? You're everything I hope for. You're everything I need. You are so beautiful to God. Are you ready? Are you ready? Jesus is knocking on your heart's door. Open your heart and invite him in. Like Miss June did many years ago. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Pass the ammunition of godly principles. Red, yellow, brown, black, and white were all precious in Jesus' sight. Find you a church to go to, as Billy Diamond would say. There's a chair waiting for you at any church. God bless you all. And God bless my wonderful wife, Miss June Diamond Stevenson, the love of my life. And my children, Guido Guy Stevenson, his wife Amy, and the grandkids and the kids, and Holly Smith Stevenson, bless her heart, Johnson. Bless her and Bill, Holly, and Bill, Johnson. Bless Pam. Pam and all the children. Cody and Ike, gone off to college. And of course, that wonderful Bo Archer. What a wonderful man, a wonderful mother, and a wonderful father and family. And Pam's family. Don and Jim. And the Bentons. And the Stevens. How wonderful. And of course, little Colleen Michelle Garnet. Stevens and Fox. Bless her little heart. Watch over her and protect her. Watch over Jeff. And give him wisdom. In Jesus' name we do ask it. For all of them. But particularly tonight, for our birthdays, my wife, Miss June, and all of her family members that are sick and ill and fighting illnesses and bones broken and sickness. Watch over them. Give them strength. Lonnie and Sil in particular. Jim and Kathy. And Rose and Jim and Heidi and Dave and Keith and Kenny and Jenny and Amy and all their families. Watch over them. Miss June and Joe B and Donna. Bless their hearts, their family. And watch over me, Lord, and give me strength, energy, going into my 81st year. Be with my friends, the Hammonds, in their mid-80s. Praise the Lord. And watch over our radio station, WIOK 107.5 FM on the radio dial. Post Office Box 50, Falmouth, Kentucky, 41040 zip code. If you got any questions, give me a call, 859-750-0000. Protect little Rachel driving in here from Arizona. Find her a place to live, a place where she can worship the Lord, play some music, and sing some music. In Jesus' name we do ask it. Amen. Watch over Mary Shulkers. Be with her. Darius has gone on to heaven. All of your other friends need prayers. Jim Noakes and Larry Hensley. Pray for him, Lord. Pray for him. And Stephen Brandon, pray for him. And Susan Brandon, pray for her. Lift their spirits up. Forgive them, Lord, for they know not what they do. In Jesus' name we ask it for all of them. Amen. Including our justice system, which needs to be lifted up and corrected. And realize the injustice that they sometimes they do, knowingly and unknowingly. Thank you, Lord. Thank you very much. God bless you. Have a great day. 859-750-0000. Join us on YouTube and Facebook under Travels with Dr. John Stevenson. STEPHENSON.